Across the developing world, governments and utility companies are working to expand the grid, to provide electricity to the 1 billion people who still don't have it. This is mostly happening in and around rapidly growing cities, where populations are dense and existing infrastructure can be extended. Still, for many, often rural customers, grid electricity is unavailable or unaffordable. They need off-grid energy solutions. There are nearly 3 billion people today who still live with little or no energy. And what I want to know is how they'll finally get it.
So this is sort of what it was. That's the future.
That's the future.
I'm Scott Tinker, and I study energy.
Where all the different people live.
Come with me around the world to meet people and communities as they switch on.
So you told me when we were driving here this morning you saw giraffes?
In the Maasai territories of Kenya, I met with Isaiah, a Maasai tribesman who's also a traveling salesman.
So we're standing under power lines right now, which I didn't expect.
This was a government project, but there is no power supply to the community here.
Okay.
To take the electricity from this place to the homesteads will take time. It will be a little bit costly.
I asked Kenyan energy consultant Elsie Mabugua about the country's rural electrification efforts.
The grid is really extending quickly. Mm-hmm. What percentage of the country actually gets access to the grid now?
You know, depending on who you talk to, you might be between the 50 and 70% range.
Right.
That's significant from where we were even a decade ago.
It's crazy. Yeah.
Most of the grid passes through the sort of the central part of the country. Mm-hmm. I would say much of the northern part of the country and western parts of the country, a lot more needs to be done. In many ways, we have limited resources within government, and so you have to be very thoughtful about where you're putting your money.
Often, this means that bringing electricity to the most remote areas becomes a lower priority. Isaiah works for MCOPA, a Kenyan company stepping in to provide electricity where the grid does not.
Hey, they are listening to the MCOPA radio.
Okay.
And they are saying it is very good because it is portable.
Yeah.
And it has a very clear sound.
That's perfect. And they get good reception here.
Yes. And they get the news of what is happening all over the world.
Oh, yeah.
As well, they have the lights, so they light the house. They have kids.
Okay.
Who go to school. So the light is helping the kids, do their homework.
Right.
Yeah, in the evening.
Isaiah, you were raised in this community.
Yes.
You went to school here.
Yes.
Did you have any electricity in school or home?
Not at all.
No.
We didn't have any.
So this is really changing lives.
This one is automatically changing our life, and it is putting us to another standard.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
Yes.
What we're currently seeing at the moment is there's a significant number of startups, young, very bright entrepreneurs who've come to resolve and actually get people who are not connected to the grid access to power.
Companies like MCOPA hire young locals who know the area, culture, and language to sell home solar systems. Isaiah and I were here to install one.
Nice to meet you. Well, we should probably get started.
These home solar systems consist of a battery. It's powered by a small solar panel on the roof. It can charge a portable radio, flashlight, or cell phone. Run some low wattage LEDs in the house.
Okay, we can just pull it a little bit this way.
That one is okay.
Is that good?
Yeah, that one is good.
Okay.
Even run a very efficient TV.
The power. Got it.
In Nairobi, I met with MCOPA's director of marketing, Pauline Githugu.
We have about 200 staff who are within the call center.
200?
Yeah, and the basic activity here is to support our customers, making sure he knows that it's, you know, on credit, he knows how to pay for it, and then we switch it on.
Yeah. Young people?
Yes.
A lot of buzz.
Yes, I'd say our average age here is probably 28 or maybe even younger within the call center. The payment for this is done by mobile money.
So that comes through?
So
a
that
mobile
comes,
network?
Yes, that comes through a mobile network. So this device has a SIM card. So it operates like a mobile phone. Say I want to pay 50 cents today. I'll go to the phone and I will pay M-Copper. And once it recognizes that, M-Copper sends a message to the customer on this device that you now have 1 day of credit.
Okay. Yeah. So there's mobile technology that's allowing all of this
absolutely
transaction
at the back end.
To
yes.
happen.
Yes. Yes.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. So I can activate it now. Okay.
All right. Showtime. So we count to three. 3, 2, 1. Ah! Woo! There it is.
Very much.
A remote.
He's saying that it is very good.
Oh, yes.
They are having now their
quality.
First pictures.
Congratulations.
They are very happy.
Wonderful. Doesn't look like something I want to drink, Pauline.
No, it's not. So these are a representation of just how much kerosene a family would use if they were not using an M-Copper device. So these are 365 bottles, which is just about the same amount of time a customer needs to pay off for one of our products. So you can imagine this is all they inhale for close to a year.
Right.
And for many years.
Right. They had to spend money on this too.
Yes. So it's actually a displacement product.
Yeah.
So instead of paying for this, then you now pay for clean energy that you eventually own and don't have to pay for at the end of it.
Yeah. So this is it. If you don't have the ability to use your phone and pay, you don't do this.
No, you can't do this.
This is the heart of your business.
Yeah.
Is this something that Kenya, M-Copper, and others can share and export to the
absolutely.
World?
Absolutely. I think this is something that we've proved can really work, but it is really predicated on the existence of a good mobile network.
It's phenomenal that you have technology that allows people who did not have access to financial services.
Right.
To finally be able to pay for their goods.
Yeah.
That's a game changer.
Right.
That means kids can actually study, you know, in areas where that would not have been possible before.
Right.
It's a, sort of the dynamic, it's a domino effect that that touches on every aspect of people's lives.
These home solar systems won't run a stove or a refrigerator, but they bring light for reading and connection to the outside world. To change lives at a cost that off-grid customers can afford. And cost is a significant concern. Though the grid already reaches this rural neighborhood outside Nairobi, farmer John Kadenda has found an energy solution that works better for his finances and needs.
And then I have the tomatoes, which requires a lot of attention.
Would all of this grow with natural rainfall, or do you have to use more water?
Nothing. You get nothing.
Really? It wouldn't
this
grow
hand,
at all?
This, do you know, the next rain we expect here in March.
It's January now.
We're in January. So
right, so you have to irrigate.
I have to irrigate.
How does the water get from your system to the plants?
I could get a solar system that has a pump that is solar powered. Right. And this being sub-Saharan Africa, that to me was key, where I can just use the solar energy, which is available like 365 days a year. I've been having the pump for the last 4 months, and there's no single day I've not had sun.
Really?
Or I've never used an electric pump. Because what I do, I have a tank, and I just pump water to the tank.
Okay.
And if it's in the evening, I want to do sprinkling,
yeah,
I just put on and it works.
So you're pumping water to a tank that's elevated, and then when you need it,
I just
use gravity.
Here we have the solar panel.
Yeah, what's the capacity in the?
80 watts each, so total of 160 watts.
What does a system like this cost?
You give them a deposit of $100. They supply you the equipment. So what you're supposed to do after that is you pay $45 a month for the next 12 months, and the system is all yours. And what I get from the farm, I can comfortably pay the $45.
Okay, so your costs are covered here by what you get every month?
Comfortably.
That's fantastic. Yeah.
Samir Ibrahim is the American-educated, Silicon Valley-style entrepreneur who started Sun Culture that built John's system.
Most farmers in Africa live off-grid.
Yeah.
And they live in rural areas like this. They make up two-thirds of the workforce. Yeah. Farmers make money in two ways. They either sell their crops or they sell milk from their livestock. Hmm. Both of those two things need water.
Right.
So a lot of people, but rain's unpredictable, undependable, leaves them one bad rainy season away from being completely wiped out.
Yep.
Where most farmers use these buckets, and they fill buckets up from a water source, which is either on their farm or nearby,
right.
And they fill it up with 20 liters of water.
50 pounds.
And lulling it around for their domestic needs, for their agriculture needs, and it's heavy. 70% of the farmers in Africa are women. Yeah. Our farmers actually tell us that the woman of the household spends over 17 hours a week lifting weights for their livelihood.
Whoa, it's way down there.
It's really deep.
Yeah.
Hand dug.
So how deep is the water itself? It looks like the top of the water is at least 10, 12
feet. It should
be
more than 50 feet deep the whole way.
50 feet?
Yeah, 50 feet. So it's really deep.
So you've got a lot of water in here, a lot of water.
I pump the whole day. I have the water all year round also.
Wow.
Initially, I used to pull the water manually with a bucket and a rope. That was really tough.
Oh, no kidding.
Yes.
So can you do this without a well like this? Is it possible to farm like this?
No. Really. If it's possible, then you have to rely on you have to time with the seasons.
Okay.
When you have the rains. Yeah. And you know what that means? You'll have it at the same time with everyone.
Right.
So the market, you all meet at the market.
Too much supply, no demand, and then there's...
Now I can just time when I want to plant or even harvest.
Yeah.
So I can play with the market, the demand and supply. Yeah.
In Africa,
right.
We have 60% of the world's unused farmable land.
Okay. Of
the world's unused farmable land.
Right.
We're the only continent, when we talk about water scarcity, it's not a physical water scarcity, it's an economic water scarcity. People just can't afford to pull the water up.
Right.
So this is good for 5 acres.
Yeah.
And most farmers here have just about two. Mm. When you think about selling water pumps, you have to be very careful to not overspec because we have precious resources underground.
Sure.
We are very food insecure. And the reason is this, we've not made farming profitable. And I think that's why the food production systems are failing in Africa. We don't have youth engaged in farming. The average age of the farmer is increasing. You find that up to 50-year-olds are the ones doing the farming. You need to cut on overhead costs.
Mm-hmm.
One of it is the energy consumption. Like now, if you're using electricity or diesel to pump your water, definitely that would be very expensive. If you were to make the farming profitable, the youth would not walk away from it.
Africa only contributes to about 15% of global agriculture output and is projected to import $100 billion of food in the next 20 years. My dream is to prove this out in a way where we get dozens of companies doing this.
Yeah.
With hundreds of thousands, not millions of acres under irrigation, with modular energy management services and a system so that people can plug in other appliances, and that people have the choice of what they do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're very fortunate. We can choose what we do, when we use power, when we take a shower, when we watch TV.
Right.
We want to give people that choice. We want to give people that freedom. And I think it has to do with energy. I think it has to do with connectivity.
Sure.
But I think it's giving people the freedom to choose how they do, what they do, and when they do it.
Right.
And I think that we can get there, not only across Kenya, but across Africa and around the world. Mm. I think in 5 years, we'll have picked up steam.
What I just do now, I just place it to a location I want it to pump.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a simple setup.
You just physically connect it and the pump
starts
and the sprinkler goes.
Yes. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Yeah.
Let's sprinkle.
Let's see. There.
I can hear it.
Wow.
Whoa.
Yeah, you have it.
That's spraying. I mean, it's spraying far.
Yes. And I think what will be good is for me to get 4 sprinklers at the same time. And
now you're thinking big.
Yes.
Across the developing world, several things are coming together to make small solar energy systems possible. Inexpensive solar panels, LED lighting and small electronics and appliances that keep getting cheaper and more efficient.
What?
Mobile phones and electronic banking that allow payment of microloans. And tech startups that want to combine them to serve off-grid customers. Wherever there's plentiful sun, these things are making home solar systems affordable and available. And they'll help millions of people begin to experience the benefits of energy.